Good morning, family in Christ. We live in a world that is in turmoil. If there are not natural disasters, then there are national disasters. When trouble is all around us, we easily begin to grow anxious and even fearful. When leaders are battling for power and driven by greed, we can easily forget that God is the sovereign over the universe. Dear friends, let us remember that the Lord is our strength and protection. In Christ alone, we find strength in weakness and rest in chaos. Martin Luther's great hymn, A Mighty Fortress, that we sometimes sing at our church, is based on Psalm 46. Psalm 46 says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Let us pray. Sovereign Lord, there are many kings and rulers over nations, but you are the true, eternal King of kings and Lord of lords. Without your strength, we are weak. Without your protection, we are helpless. Without your peace, we become overwhelmed with dread. Yet when we trust in you, we can walk in confidence. When we live for you, we find fulfillment. When we honor you as Lord over our lives, we find deep comfort. Father, may our worship be pleasing to you and our hearts be ready to receive your holy word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
You step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God, and you're all together lovely, all together. So highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all full of sin became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am. Here I am.
to see my sin upon that cross. Here I am to worship. Our scripture reading this morning is from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, from chapter 3, from verse 7. Hear the word of the Lord. Now, if the ministry that brought death, chiseled in letters on stones, came with glory, so that the Israelites were not able to gaze steadily at Moses' face because of the glory which was set aside, how will the ministry of the Spirit not be more glorious? For if the ministry that brought condemnation had glory, the ministry that brings righteousness overflows with even more glory. In fact, what had been glorious is not glorious now by comparison, because of the glory that surpasses it. For if what was set aside was glorious, what endures will be even more glorious. Since then we have such a hope, we act with great boldness. We are not like Moses, who used to put a veil over his face to prevent the Israelites from gazing steadily until the end of the glory of what was being set aside. But their minds were hardened, for to this day, at the reading of the Old Covenant, the same veil remains. It is not lifted, because it is set aside only in Christ. Yet still today, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts, but whenever a person turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. We all with unveiled faces are looking as in a mirror at the glory of the Lord, and are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory. This is from the Lord, who is the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord. May He bless it to our hearts.
Let us pray. Father, you are our Father. You are a father who loves his children with an everlasting love. You are a father who relates to us personally as a true affectionate parent towards his children. You pour out your goodness on all of your creation and show special favor towards those who abide and live in loving obedience towards your Son. You see things from an eternal, heavenly, perfect perspective. Your kingdom is eternal, and your will is perfect. Holy Father, we have all sinned against you. Instead of loving you with all our hearts, we have been divided in our hearts and even rebellious in our intentions and affections against you. Instead of loving you with all our minds, we have entertained lies from the enemy and from our sinful imaginations. Instead of loving you with all our souls, we have valued earthly possessions, praise, and power. Instead of loving you with all our strength, we have wasted our strength, time, and abilities on things that dishonor you and grieve the Holy Spirit. Our performance clearly cannot earn our salvation. We have no reason to boast in anything we have done. It is only through Jesus Christ, who was sinless and holy, that we can stand. And we look to you. We look to Jesus Christ, only trusting in the person of Christ and his work on the cross can reunite us back to yourself. Thank you, Lord, that although we struggle against sin, we can rejoice in Romans 8 verse 1 that says, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." Thank you for your forgiveness that frees us from the prison of sin, your righteousness that enables us to come into a relationship with the Holy God, and your love that covers a multitude of sins, even those we are unaware of. We pray for our country and for the church globally. May you raise up leaders who love you, both in our country and church, to guide and shepherd your people to living God-honoring lives. May you give Christians courage to stand for the truth and compassion to love all people, even those who despise you and ourselves. May we love what is good, beautiful, and true as you do, and hate wickedness as you do. Purify our hearts and renew our minds so that we do not grow hardened or indifferent towards sin. We pray for wisdom for the daily choices we make and opportunities to make a difference wherever we are. May you greatly use ministers and missionaries in our country and beyond to know the gospel and spread it. Lord, teach us how to pray and love your word more, to love you deeply, to share the good news to others, to live obedient lives, and use our time, abilities, and strength for you. We thank you for Jeremy and Karen and pray that they will continue to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. May you guide our counsel into making decisions that glorify you, and may each of us in our church love you more and become more like Christ every day. May we decrease and you increase in our lives. We pray that you will comfort those suffering and their loved ones during this difficult time. May you provide for those in desperate need and continue to give us what we need. We thank you for your grace and greatness in our lives. May we glorify you in return, and may you receive all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, dear church family. We are busy looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 6 through 18. If you want to open your Bibles to that section. The Corinthian church had been infiltrated by Judaizers. They were the false teachers proclaiming that the old covenant was equal to the new covenant. They wanted believers to embrace the Mosaic ceremonies, the traditions, rituals, and feasts, and include them as part of their worship. They wanted the old covenant to be added to the new covenant. Paul, who before his dramatic conversion on the road to Damascus was steeped in the old covenant, did not want them, the Corinthians, to follow a gospel plus. He tells us in Philippians chapter 3, verse 4, "If anyone else thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless." He was so steeped in the old covenant that he went around arresting and killing those who were following the new covenant. But on that road to Damascus, Christ opened his eyes and showed him the superiority of the new covenant. This caused Paul to conclude in Philippians chapter 3, verse 7, "But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord." And this is what he wanted the Corinthian believers to understand. In Christ, you have everything. You don't need to add anything to this glorious gospel. These verses are really a summary of the book of Hebrews, the purpose of which is to highlight how Christ is the fulfillment of the old covenant. Paul wants to make it very clear to the Corinthians that the new covenant is way more superior than the old covenant. The Judaizers were clouding the simple gospel and confusing people. The scribes and Pharisees did the same. Jesus told his disciples in Matthew 23, verse 4, "They," that's the scribes and Pharisees, "tie up heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on people's shoulders." They had created an elaborate system of religious works so that people could work their way to being right with God. It led to Jesus saying this in Matthew 23, verse 13, "But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut the kingdom of heaven in people's faces, for you neither enter yourselves nor allow those who would enter to go in. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you travel across sea and land to make a single proselyte, and when he becomes a proselyte, you make him twice as much a child of hell as yourselves." Their works religion was leading people to hell. Martin Luther had a similar experience. The gospel had got lost in amongst all the religiosity. Luther said, "Though I lived as a monk without reproach, I felt that I was a sinner before God with an extremely disturbed conscience. I could not believe that he was placated by my satisfaction." And he's referring here to all the works the church had imposed on people to make them right with God. He goes on, "I did not love, yes, I hated the righteous God who punishes sinners and secretly, if not blasphemously, certainly murmuring greatly. I was angry with God and said, as if indeed it is not enough that miserable sinners eternally lost through original sin, are crushed by every kind of calamity, by the law of the Decalogue, without having God add pain to pain by the gospel, and also by the gospel threatening us with his righteousness and wrath. Thus I raged with a fierce and troubled conscience. At last, by the mercy of God, meditating day and night, I gave heed to the context of the words, namely, in it the righteousness of God is revealed, as it is written, he who through faith is righteous shall live. There I began to understand the righteousness of God is that by which the righteous lives by a gift of God, namely by faith. And this is the meaning. The righteousness of God is revealed by the gospel, namely the passive righteousness with which merciful God justifies us by faith. As it is written, he who through faith is righteous shall live. Here I felt that I was altogether born again and had entered paradise itself through open gates. There a totally other face of the entire scripture showed itself to me. End quote. The Reformation was like a huge ship whose hull was full of 1,500 years worth of barnacles, human traditions and religious practices that were stifling the church and that desperately needed to be scraped away in order to free the church from the shackles that had turned God's free gift of salvation into something man-made. Those reformers had to recapture the simple gospel and then relaunch a seaworthy vessel. Through their efforts and sacrifice, we enjoy this glorious gospel. But the Reformation must never stop. Today, we still have many cults and religions that want to add sacraments, rituals, ceremonies, and external things to the simple gospel, which obscures the spiritual simplicity. There is even a group that wants to drag people back to the old covenant by introducing all the Jewish rituals, feasts, and ceremonies into their worship. All this does is devalue what Christ has done for us. Now remember, Paul is defending his ministry and his integrity throughout this letter. And one of the ways he does that is to state that true ministers are preachers of the new covenant only. He says in verse 6, God has made us competent to be ministers, that's servants, of a new covenant. And he's contrasting with the false teachers who were ministers of the old covenant. Paul is saying, I have taught you the new covenant. Why then would you want to go back to the old covenant? Covenant is simply a promise. So what was the new promise? It was the promise of salvation through faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone, which means the complete forgiveness of all your sin made possible through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That is God's promise. He promised to take away your sin, to remember your sins no more, Isaiah 43 verse 25, to remove them as far as the east is from the west, Psalm 103 verse 12, because of the work of Jesus Christ that he achieved on the cross, Colossians 1 verse 20. That's the new covenant. That's the gospel. Paul wants to remind these Corinthian believers how much better the new covenant is. And he does this by highlighting 10 aspects of the superiority of the new covenant. First, the new covenant brings life. Verse 6, God has made us competent to be ministers of a new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit, for the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. The old covenant was a covenant carved in letters on stone, verse 7, referring to the Ten Commandments, and it could not give life. When you place your life next to the law of God, it kills you, because it shows that you're unable to live up to God's law. Romans 3 verse 10 says, none is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. Comparing our lives against the law only produces death. Romans 6 verse 23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's why Paul called the old covenant the ministry of death in verse 7 and the ministry of condemnation in verse 9. The old covenant was a killer. Not only can you not live up to God's law, according to Galatians chapter 3 verse 10, for all who rely on works of the law are under a curse. For it is written, cursed be everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law and do them. Now it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. But the law is not of faith. Rather, the one who does them shall live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. And curse means eternal damnation. So the law places us under a curse, and only Christ can redeem us from that curse. So what then was the purpose of the Old Covenant? The Old Covenant was made up of three components: a civil component, a ceremonial, and a moral component. The civil component prescribed how the people of God were to live. They were to set apart by God to live differently from the pagan, polytheistic world around them. God wanted to protect them from becoming polluted by the world and destroying their testimony. But all they wanted was to be like those around them, and that destroyed their testimony. The civil part identified Israel as a unique nation under God. But in the new covenant, this has been set aside. Now there is no more Jew and Gentile. We are all one in Christ. The ceremonial part of the law encompassed all the symbols, the sacrificial system, the Sabbaths, feasts, and festivals. They were all meant to point to the redemptive plan of God in Christ. Man needs to be redeemed, and God, through these old covenant symbols, was showing how he was going to accomplish that redemption. They were all pointing ahead to something much greater. The ceremonial part was set aside when Christ came, because he was the reality that the symbols represented. The third part of the law was the moral part. That's the only part that is permanent and eternal, because it reveals who God is, his character, and his will for man. It's why Jesus, when asked by the experts in the law, which is the greatest commandment, he replied in Matthew 22, verse 34, with, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets." Here's the important part. None of these three aspects of the law can save you. The civil and ceremonial law pointed ahead to the coming Messiah, and when he came, they all fell away, because Christ was the fulfillment of all the symbols. The moral law remains, and its purpose in the old covenant, as well as the new, is to drive us to the place where we see our sin for what it is, and cry out in desperation to God for his mercy and grace to save us. That's what all the Old Testament saints did. We have a wonderful picture of this in Luke 18. Where Jesus tells us a parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector. It's worth noting that this parable is told before Jesus' crucifixion, resurrection, or ascension, and before the Holy Spirit has come at Pentecost, nor has the New Testament been completed. Luke 18, verse 10. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, "God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I get." You see, he was comparing himself to others instead of to the law. He had adopted a works salvation. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. The tax collector had seen the Ten Commandments, knew that he could not keep any of them, and cried out to God to have mercy on him. That's what the moral law was supposed to do. Now listen to Jesus' final words as he wrapped up his teaching on this parable. He said, I tell you, this man, that's the tax collector, went down to his house justified. He was made right with God rather than the Pharisee. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. God gave us the law to show us his character and his will, and to demonstrate that his standards are way beyond us. The result of this realization is to call out to God and plead for his mercy, and God in his grace and mercy will forgive us our sin through the work of his Son, Jesus Christ. The result is life. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. John 14, verse 6. In John chapter 6, verse 35, Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, but whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Jesus also said, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. John chapter 10, verse 10. The old covenant can only bring death, but the new covenant, the glorious gospel of Christ, brings life, because the new covenant is all about the life giver. Second, the new covenant gives more glory. Verse 8, will not the ministry of the Spirit have even more glory? Now Paul uses a Hebrew form of argument here, taking us from the lesser to the greater. He gives us three examples. First, verse 7, from the lesser. Now if the ministry of death, carved in letters on stone, came with such glory that the Israelites could not gaze at Moses' face because of its glory, which was being brought to an end, and then to the greater, will not the ministry of the Spirit have even more glory? The law came with great glory. It was so great that it exercised the ministry of judgment and death on Israel, because they could not keep one aspect of the law. That is why the people were afraid to look at the reflected glory coming off Moses' face. He had to cover his face when speaking with them. And therefore, if Moses' ministry came with such glory that it had to be veiled, how much more glorious is Paul's unveiled ministry of the Spirit that constantly convicts people, exposing them to God's glory and transforming their lives. Second, verse 9, from the lesser. For if there was glory in the ministry of condemnation, and then to the greater, the ministry of righteousness must far exceed it in glory. Indeed, in this case, what once had glory has come to have no glory at all because of the glory that surpasses it. The ministry of condemnation refers to the effects of the law, which produced death. But the ministry of righteousness exceeds the old covenant in glory because it gives life. This was foretold by the prophets. In Ezekiel chapter 11, verse 19 and 20, he says, And I will give them one heart. This is God speaking. And I will give them one heart, and a new spirit I will put within them. I will remove the heart of stone from their flesh and give them a heart of flesh, that they may walk in my statutes and keep my rules and obey them. And then they shall be my people, and I will be their God. In the new covenant, believers will receive the ministry of the Holy Spirit, who will help them obey God's law. That's why Paul says in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The old covenant was indeed glorious, but the effects of the new covenant is far more glorious in its ministry of righteousness, because it gives those who trust in Christ a righteousness not their own. And the third comparison, this caps Paul's argument for the surpassing glory of his ministry, verse 11 from the Lesser. For if what was being brought to an end came with glory, then to the greater, much more will what is permanent have glory. What was being brought to an end was the old covenant. In contrast, the new covenant is permanent. It rests in Christ, who is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, and therefore is far more glorious. Paul, using a three-pronged logic, declares that his ministry is far more glorious than that of Moses because of its unlimited exposure to God's glory. It's a ministry of righteousness. It's a ministry of the Holy Spirit, and it is permanent. Now, this is amazing. Paul is placing himself above Moses' ministry because his ministry brought a greater glory. And it was greater because, as Colossians 1 verse 27 says, to them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. With the promise in Colossians chapter 3 verse 4 that when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. In the new covenant, the glory of God is not just restricted to one person on one occasion like it was with Moses. Verse 18, and we all with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. And all those who are in Christ can see the glory of the Lord. Why then would you want to go back to the old covenant? Why would you want God to veil his glory when you have the reality in Christ? You and I can see the glory of God, not through a Moses-like figure. The veil has been removed, and we can look at the glory of God revealed in the face of our Lord Jesus Christ. And Christ becomes visible through his word. Remember in Matthew 17, Jesus took his closest disciples up the mountain where he showed them his glory. Verse 2 says, and he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. Peter, recalling that event, says in 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 16, for we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty or glory. Christ is the glory of God unveiled to the eyes of faith. A person who is not a Christian cannot see the glory of Christ. The Romans didn't see it, and they crucified him. The Jewish leaders didn't see it, and they mocked and spat on him. But to the eye of faith, Christ is the glory of God, and the pursuit of the Christian life is to be transformed into the image of Christ from one degree of glory to another. It's why Paul said in 1 Corinthians 2 verse 2, for I decided to know nothing among you except Christ and him crucified. Only the ministry of the Holy Spirit has the power to remove the veil and give you the eyes of faith to see the glory of Christ. Paul saw what John wrote in John chapter 1 verse 14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. Paul saw the glory of Christ on that Damascus road, and it transformed his whole life. Has this glorious gospel transformed your life? The new covenant comes by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone and provides what the old covenant could never provide. First, it provides eternal life. Second, it provides a far greater glory. We'll pick up the rest next time, but for now, let us pray. O gracious Lord, we're so grateful that you have lifted the veil and that you've allowed us to see the glory of Christ. We thank you that you have given us life in Christ and shown us the greater glory of the new covenant. We lift up to you all those who continue to have your glory hidden from their sight. Help them to see your glory, and may they also be transformed into your image. We have been allowed to see your magnificent glory that is veiled to them, and we are overwhelmed by your wonderful grace and mercy to us undeserving sinners. We thank you and praise you in Christ's name. Amen.
Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ the
pray. The peace of God, which is above all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you this day and for always. Amen.